It's 8 a.m. at the Jose Favela Hospital in the Philippine capital, Manila. In the past 12 hours, there have been about 40 births, a fairly average night for one of the world's busiest maternity wards.
As you can see, there's more patients than there are resources for them.
Dr. Silvia De La Paz, the chief obstetrician here, says they manage the crush as best they can, often putting two beds together as a tandem bed for four mothers and four newborns. And from these overcrowded hospital wards, right out into the teeming slums of the city, it's easy to see that this country is in the midst of a population explosion, what some are calling a crisis. The Philippines today has one of the highest birth rates in Asia, with a population that has more than doubled in the last three decades, from 45 million to 100 million.
Once the mothers and their newborns leave the maternity hospital, many are going to return to places like Tondo. This gritty neighborhood right on the edge of Manila is a place where families still struggle to get by on $1 or $2 a day at best.
Here, very young children scavenge through garbage in search of something to sell for a few dollars to help support their families. Families in Asia's most Catholic country that have had little or no access to contraception or family planning advice. Families often getting larger by the year. Vilma Lopez has 10 children, ages 1 to 20. She had her first child at 19.
We didn't plan it. It just happened every year. It's just easy for me to get pregnant.
Manila is now one of the most densely populated urban areas on Earth. So congested today, some are forced to seek refuge in local cemeteries where they eat and sleep on tombs and mausoleums.
In the Philippines, there is family planning, but it is available only to the rich, to those who are able to afford to go see doctors, to buy pills.
Esperanza Cabral, a former health secretary of the Philippines, has been sounding the alarm on the population crisis here, a population growing fastest among the poorest Filipinos, those whose need for birth control is the greatest.
For the poorer among us, it is often an aspiration, something they want to do but are not able to do.
Dr. Silvia De La Paz says teen pregnancies are at an all-time high.
With the lack of contraceptives, so what else will they do? Have babies, more and more babies. No, so it's a sad picture.
For years, the UN has urged the Philippine government to take action to provide free contraception and family planning for the poor. Recent surveys indicate 8 in 10 Filipinos now agree. But the Philippines' most powerful institution, the Roman Catholic Church, has fought family planning policies every time they are raised. In a country where more than 80% are practicing Catholics, the Church has dominated nearly every aspect of life for more than 400 years. Its moral authority and political power rarely challenged, especially when it comes to reproduction. Abortion here is strictly illegal, although rare exceptions are made if the health of the mother is at risk. Outside the Vatican, this is the only country in the world where divorce is still not allowed. And while the Philippine Church says it's not opposed to natural family planning, avoiding intercourse when a woman is most fertile, it remains opposed to all forms of artificial contraception. Retired Archbishop Oscar Cruz.
Contraception in the eyes of the Church is still immoral.
Yes.
You do believe it leads to promiscuity, among other things.
Yes.
If the people of the Philippines are in support of population control and contraception, and they want their children to learn in school proper family planning education, why would the Church oppose any of that?
The Church promotes parenthood. Only let it be responsible parenthood. The Church has never said, go ahead, multiply as much as you like and let the good Lord provide. No. The Church preaches responsible parenthood. through natural family planning.
But changes are now underway in the Philippines that could help slow the population boom. This past spring, after a 15-year battle that went all the way to the Philippine Supreme Court, a new reproductive health care law took effect. It requires the Philippine government to fund family planning health clinics, provide affordable contraception, and launch comprehensive sex education in schools. Former Health Secretary Cabral, one of the most prominent supporters of the new law, says it's about time.
It's a victory for all Filipinos, especially women and children. I think that the law can make a very big dent on our problem with poverty and population.
So was this a defeat for the Catholic Church?
I think so.
This fight went on for 15 years, and with all due respect, Archbishop, the church lost.
Yes. Yes. What's new? The church teaches, the world does not listen. If the church teaches and the world listen, that would be a first-class miracle.
Still, before the bill was implemented, the church and its supporters won some major concessions from the Supreme Court, effectively diluting the law. Private hospitals owned by religious institutions will not have to provide family planning options or even refer patients to hospitals that will provide the services. Minors seeking birth control pills or condoms will require parental consent. And married women will have to have their husband's consent if they want to undergo a fertility procedure like inserting an IUD.
Our main concern is that we're looking at that women and young girls have the right to choose, you know, freely and responsibly number of children they want when they want them.
Klaus Beck is the head of the United Nations Population Fund in the Philippines. While he cheers the passage of the reproductive health care law here, he says that for the law to be effective, it must empower women to make their own choices, which the current law now limits. Without those choices, many women may still feel the need to seek out abortions. And here in Manila, that means a visit to what could be described as an abortion black market. Right outside the 400-year-old Church of the Black Nazarene, right alongside the rosary beads and the statues of saints, shopkeepers openly offer a variety of herbs and potions, promising to induce menstruation as a way to end unwanted pregnancies. For the equivalent of $5, we were able to buy this concoction, what the vendor described as an herbal remedy, a brew that's supposed to induce miscarriages in the first trimester of pregnancy. Others may find it necessary to seek out someone in these back alleys to perform an abortion. We met up with a woman called Rose, who did not want to be identified on camera. Rose says she has assisted doctors performing hundreds of abortions.
Every day we had 3 to 5 patients because it would only take 15 minutes for each procedure.
According to the Center for Reproductive Rights, there are more than 500,000 illegal abortions in the Philippines every year. An estimated 1,000 women die every year of complications from those procedures. While the limitations of the new reproductive health care law are clear, former Health Secretary Cabral is optimistic that it will eventually lower the number of unwanted pregnancies and eventually slow the population growth.
Even though the primary purpose of the bill is not population control, as we know from other countries, if you give mothers a chance, what actually happens is the population growth rate goes down.
For Cabral and many other Filipinos, failure is not an option. The need to control this country's population growth is becoming a matter of survival for Filipinos today. From the cradle to those graveyards where people are now living as squatters because they have nowhere else to live.